Well, hello, and welcome to the Dating Advisory Board, show number 2 on WLVS Radio. We have an amazing show here for you guys tonight. I have the amazing Molly Pompadith, the CEO and founder of the Sora Community Network. She is a marketing strategist and author. We're going to get into her books here in a second. And she actually is executive producer of her own show, The Tea with Molly, which is awesome. So if you haven't signed up, go on Molly's page, storecommunitynetwork.com, right?
Yes.
Right. So make sure you sign up. She's got amazing events going on. But the reason why I'm so excited to have her here today is because we were going to talk a lot about how important community is and to have your have a community in your personal and your professional life. And just like the Store Community Network and the Dating Advisory Board, to be the best versions of yourself and to help and empower others. We're also going to get into, I added a new clip to the show this week, dating horror stories. And that's really funny. So we'll get into that in a second. But we're going to talk about the dating profiles, do's and don'ts. We're seeing in the news, social media tips that you can use in your personal life as well as your business. And we're going to do here in a minute the love song lyric interpretation. So can't wait to get your feedback on that. So, I'm going to have Molly give us an introduction of who she is.
Well, hello everyone. I'm Molly Pompadith. As Jen mentioned, I'm the CEO of the SOAR Community Network, otherwise known as SCN. And I'm also a podcaster and the host and producer of Tea with Molly, which she mentioned.
Yeah.
And what we focus on really is helping entrepreneurs and businesses soar in the market through strategy, growth development, leadership programs, and technology. Just really everything that allows a small business owner to take their business to the next level. And sometimes it's even helping them just, you know, at the launch phase.
Yeah.
And then watch them over time grow and message with heart and show up authentically. And so all the programs are all about that.
Yeah. And, you know, we are going to talk about one of the questions here in a little bit is creating your vision mission map, right?
Yes.
For the year, because you have to have a plan in place for what you're going to do. I always have my whiteboards. Just see my basement wall. I mean, it's all filled up, all the stuff I did. But if I have it up on the wall, I know I can look at it and say, okay, here's what I'm going to do. Here's my plan. It, you know, makes you kind of push forward and do that. So.
And we have our event tomorrow for that vision, mission, map, and goal setting for 2017.
Yeah.
So we've got it's for women business owners tomorrow. It's exciting.
Yes, it's exciting. I mean, you need to go on their website because they have amazing events. They have lunches and breakfasts. And it, the most amazing women. And I'm so thankful to be a part of the group. Mm-hmm. And we have a great time.
Thank you.
Okay, so let's get into love lyric interpretation. And just to give a little background on that, you know, Molly, you and I know, we're both writers, poets. That's actually how we met back in the day. So, you know, I think every song, I love lyrics. And how you can interpret that in your own personal life, and you can walk away from it and saying, okay, I learned from something. And obviously you're going to, if you like that, the lyrics, you're probably going to listen to more songs by that artist, right?
Yeah.
So what we picked tonight was Rihanna, Stay. All right, Jacob, put that on.
It's not just something you do. you're the broken one, but I'm the only one who needed saving. 'Cause when you never see the light, it's hard to know which one of us is caving. Not really sure how to feel about it. Something in the way you move makes me feel like I can't live without you. Takes me out the way. I want you to stay. Stay. I want you to stay.
I know. I love that song. I love her. I love Rihanna.
Yeah.
It's pretty powerful.
It is. The line that I love is, funny, you're the broken one, but I'm the only one who needed saving. And I think it's looking at yourself in the mirror. This song is very complex because it's really about the human condition.
Right.
It's not just about a romantic love, but it's about like how we are attracted to people sometimes in the right place and time. And in the wrong situation. Sometimes you're attracted to them because they're hurting too.
Right.
And especially in romance, it's like everybody who wants to cover up when they're in pain. So even though both of you are in pain, like there's this facade you have to come, you know, show up with and saying, oh, I'm fine. And then you realize it's like a push and pull. This is what I love about this song is there's an energy to it that says, I'm hurting, but I want love, but I'm not quite... I'm still broken.
Right.
And it's just kind of like, you know, kind of hiding, but at the same time wanting and longing to for this person to stay and see the wholeness of who you are. And, you know, this music and lyrics and poetry is not supposed to be literal. It's supposed to make you feel, and it allows people, whoever they are, to interpret the words based on what's going on in their lives. So that's what I love about music and poetry.
Yeah, me too.
And I love this song because it can be interpreted in so many different ways.
Oh, yeah, so many different ways. Exactly. I mean, I think, you know, I Need This Hole Gone, right, is probably because, you know, I think we look to others to fix each other when we just need to fix ourselves first before going into relationships, or look more inward and do self-reflection on that. So that is our love song lyric interpretation. So we hope you enjoyed the song. And so now we're going to get into our interviewing fabulous Molly. So Molly, first to give the bio of your background, I mean, you have the most amazing story. I love it. And I've known you forever. So
Thank
and I
you.
Love you. You always keep me on my lane.
I
veered off in my lane for a hot minute, but she put me right back on track. So thank you for that.
You're very welcome.
Yeah. Okay, so go
ahead. Well, I guess the one thing that you wanted to find out is a little bit more about what community really means and what the SOAR Community Network means to me. Yeah. And, you know, with my background, I came here as a child refugee of war with my family, and my father worked for the old government of Laos, and he was blacklisted among many, many people, captured to the re-education camp. And so, you know, our family had to find a way out. And the long story short of it is that we arrived here in the United States with absolutely nothing. A church in Maryland sponsored our family. And when you come from a foreign place and you have really no language, you have nobody else around you that you can communicate with, it's very lonely. And I think that whether you're a refugee of war or whether you're moving to a new town, building a community or feeling like you belong somewhere is such a human need. It's such a human part of who we are. And that's why, for me, the SOAR Community Network came from even way back when, this longing, this desire to have a lot of people who are like-minded and a safe place to call home. So that's really how I think throughout all the years when I finally decided to build the SOAR Community Network, it was all of the past and the longing as a child that really impacts the way that we operate as adults.
Right.
And so that's why SOAR Community Network is so meaningful for me. It's not just helping other businesses, but it's also helping the soul of people to become the kind of leaders that can build, you know, really powerful businesses that support communities.
And it's also friends. I mean, the friends that have made from the SOAR Community Network. I mean, it's unbelievable. So it's like we said, it's not only your professional life, but it's also your personal life too. And these women are amazing, and they want to help. They want to help you be the best and fulfill your dreams. So having that kind of support from a genuine place.
And I do want to note that the SOAR Community Network is not just for women. We have lots of programs for women, but we have men, women of all ages, generations, and really coming to each other and sharing strategies that are going to help each other become successful and really, I guess, more centered.
Yes.
You know, in life
as
well as in business. So,
and I love the fact is that, you know, you talk about different ways you can improve not only your personal side, but your professional side as well. So you'll have different speakers that'll come in and you do workshops. I mean, it's really, you have to grow you as an individual first,
yes.
I think, you know, in order to kind of figure out what you're supposed to be doing. Like, you're going to evolve as a person, evolve as a, you know, in business and personal. You wouldn't want to.
No, but you know what, Jen, sometimes also, I mean, we say that so easily, right? You just have to, like, go find yourself, and it's not easy.
No.
Because you've been told so many different things your whole life. So when someone says, go to a workshop and go find yourself, it's not just one workshop that will do it. And that's why having a community and accountability partners and consistent events and personal development programs, leadership programs that you take advantage of on an ongoing basis allows for that growth, not just a one-time experience.
And if you're wondering how, you know, to get more involved, I mean, you can get, if you're not in the D.C. region, but go to other networking events in your area and reach out. The more you can expand the network of people to help give you feedback and learn from those influencers, the better off that you can start down a successful path. So
definitely. Definitely. And because the technology and social media, the way that it is, there's so many groups. That you can search for, and you can even search for through hashtags, you know, your different interests, hobbies, especially when you're trying to figure out where do you want to go from here in terms of career-wise or even project-wise or launching a business. Like, maybe you have a deep desire to do something with your passion and you just don't know how to run a business.
Yeah.
So you have to find groups that will help really nurture that entrepreneur inside of you. So many things that are available to us,
you know,
and I'm constantly learning. So even though we host
Facebook
a lot of
groups, too?
we host a lot of events, but we go to a lot of events.
That's true.
Too.
Ton of them. Now, if you were to help people create in the dating world, create their vision and mission map for online dating, this is going
to
be good.
Vision and mission map for online dating. I think first you have to really identify what you want.
Right.
I mean, how do you create a map for anything, let alone dating, when you really haven't asked yourself the question, like, what do I really want in a partner? What
right.
do I want that in terms of, you know, the type of personality, the type of person that you want to be with? You know, are they kind? What kind of activities do they like? And, you know, really being able to identify the things that light you up when you think of having a partner.
Right.
And it's not enough to just dream about it. You really have to write it down.
Right.
It makes a big difference to see it on paper. I really believe that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Like, write down your list.
Yeah. So that's the first thing, is figuring out, like, what do you want? And then the second thing, too, is learn from your past mistakes.
Okay.
Or, you know, go back and laugh about those, you know, those men or women that you've dated and don't repeat patterns.
Right,
you know?
Exactly.
We all do it, but, you know, after a while, it's kind of like, okay, you got to learn that this kind of personality or character in a person is just not going to work for me.
Right.
And work hard not to go down that path again and again and again.
Yeah.
So it starts with recognizing what you want and what you don't want. And sometimes knowing what you don't want is actually a lot more concrete than knowing what you want.
Right. Exactly. I love that. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
So now we're going to talk about in the news, because it has been a very busy week in D.C. and Molly was actually at the march. And I mean, I don't know what the numbers are now, but I mean, I know it was over 500,000 in D.C.
And I don't really know the official number, but it was massive. And I had in my mind that it was going to be a pretty big deal, of course, because of all the buzz that was happening. And, you know, one thing that I really loved about the march was there were women and men and children, and we saw, you know, 70, 80, 90-year-olds, people in wheelchairs, like just the diversity of people who were there marching for many different reasons. And I want to reiterate that, because it wasn't just one group of women or people fighting for one cause. There are a lot of fears out there, a lot of concerns, and maybe even for those that are not driven by fear, just reiterating the fact that we want to continue to be heard and be seen about the things that matter to us. So that was really what my takeaway was, the diversity, not just in the look and feel of the crowd, the massive crowd, but the issues, the diversity of the issues that were important.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, I can't imagine what the power was like down there, the energy. I mean, because it was all, you know, building a community, and this community came together. It was an example of, you know, the power that we all have in something we believe in professionally and personally. You know, you coming together to help empower other people. Yeah. I mean, there's, you can't.
And it comes down to the topic of tonight, too. What absolutely just blew me away was that you have people who always say, well, what can I do? I'm just one person, or I don't have enough following, or whatever these, you know, these self-doubt, self-talk that we have. And you have something this massive globally where, you know, a small group of people, women, who said, you know, we have to speak up for the things that matter to us. Mm-hmm. And it became an entire movement. So one message I would have is, in terms of building a community, you have to start. Yeah. To build a community. You don't just like call upon a community and the next day you wake up and say, hey, let's go do something. You have to start. You have to start with that one girlfriend or you know, group. Significant other, and then grow that mission and vision for what it is that you're fighting for or speaking up for. And that's how it all begins. Because when you see millions upon millions of people globally being, you know, being a part of Saturday, it came from an idea. It came from an idea that was driven by passion and purpose. And I think that's really what we need to focus on that. And that's what vision and mission mapping is about.
Yeah.
You know, find your passion and figure out how you're going to manifest a purpose that is not just for you, but for a whole community of people that would resonate with that idea.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, I was watching the feeds, but, you know, it was interesting. You know, I saw one feed that came over, and I quote, "There's never been a better time to be single guy in D.C. the march. I mean, I guess he had a good dating strategy, but, you know, I mean, for the right reasons. But, you know, I mean, if he was wanting to help. But, yeah, I mean, I could see that, but I just thought it was interesting.
It was funny when you told me about that. I was like, well, a lot of people probably just didn't like that comment. But, you know, I think that's also something to bring up. The context in which we jump to conclusions about what's, you know, words, like what people say. And I want to remind people that context is so important, and you can't go into someone's heart and soul and interpret for them what they mean by how they use their words.
Yeah. So. No, I agree with that. I agree with that. But, you know, again, I can't stress enough about how the importance of the community and how we can help each other in our, you know, personal and professional life, like creating that group, right? So find your group. And so here's my, here's one of my favorite sayings is, you know, call it a clan, call it a network, call it a tribe, call it a family, whatever you call it, whoever you are, you need one, right? I think that's really powerful. So thank you for that. Next, we're going to get into interview with business strategy, social media tip of the day, right? So, so you know, from your perspective, I mean, different social platforms have different messaging, right? So if give some examples. I mean, I know you wouldn't post some of the things on LinkedIn that you would post on Facebook, and how are you talking on Facebook?
Right, and I would say this. I mean, there are different platforms, and because we work with businesses, the ones that we typically work with would be LinkedIn, of course.
Yes.
And then we would also have Twitter and Facebook business pages or public profiles, and, of course, Instagram and Pinterest, right, depending on the type of company. But each one of them have their unique set of just to-dos and not-to-dos. When you're talking about authentic messaging, if you're a retail, for instance, and you want to sell products, then it's very important to have pictures and images that speak to that. If you are a professional services, you have to also be very cognizant of who's reading your stuff and who's your prospect and what kind of language are they using.
Right.
I think demographics is so important. I mean, you have different social media platforms that cater to a different demographic. A specific demographic more so than others, and that's really where you have to practice your language. So if you're speaking to a younger crowd and you're not knowing how to say the latest and greatest, you know, jokes or cliches or whatever that's hot these days, it's going to be a missed, you know, opportunity, right?
Right.
And so for business owners, I think it's very important, whoever's managing the social media, that you actually have a team,
right,
you know, of diverse groups of people as well who can speak to the energy of each platform. They
right.
are so different. And I know that a lot of folks complain about things like LinkedIn. Why are people, sharing things on LinkedIn that
right.
are not supposed to be there?
Yeah, or like should be on, like on Facebook, right?
Right.
Yes.
So that's also, everything
so
is
just
about
be yourself.
Impression.
Yeah, like dating tip, just be yourself.
Just be yourself, right? That's right, yeah. And each one allows you to be yourself, but you do have to be cognizant of the audience and the type of impression you want to make, as well as the type of call to action.
Right.
And that does make a difference on how and where you're messaging each time.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. All right. So, Jacob, you can take that one down. Then we're back. All right. So now, well, thank you for that. I appreciate that, because I think that, you know, I do see a lot on LinkedIn where they're putting, you know, just like trying to pick you up on a date for that. I think that's not the business plan.
Well, yeah, and you're going to get that in any platform. I mean, I feel like, you know, how you respond and react is more important than what you are getting in your inbox, because
right.
we get a lot of shady things. And, you know, when you're online and it's global and it's everywhere and it's for anyone to tap into, you just have to know that comes with the territory. So you have to be careful with your privacy settings and things like that. And to know what to respond to and what not to respond to. I mean, we've seen a lot of, you know, this talk about internet trolls and stuff.
Yeah.
You're going to have to also protect yourself on what makes sense to respond to and what to let go. Like, you're never going to be able to.
Like, Mima got proposed to on LinkedIn.
Right, she did.
Mirage. He went into Mirage her.
She did,
He did, yes. It was, and he said he loves her. She's never met him.
Yeah.
So, well, that's a good segue into our next segment, meaning dating horror stories of the week. Okay. So, do you have any? I got a couple, but do you have any?
I don't have any because I'm not dating right now.
Dating,
I'm married now, and you know, we date each other, and it's great. Yeah. But no horror stories. So I'm excited to hear yours.
Okay. So, I mean, this is actually not personally mine, but there's two short ones. All right. This is one is from one of our friends.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh boy.
We will not
disclose.
Okay. So apparently they went on a first date, and at the end of the night, I mean, I don't know where they went to dinner, but I mean, I don't know if it was seafood or whatever. I mean, who knows? Because this is an important point. So anyway, so the end of the night, I don't know if he went like leaned in for a kiss, and he started licking her face.
Oh my.
No, I mean, I'm not kidding. Like full on licking it, like making sure she got the forehead. And she's like, I mean, what were you supposed to do? I mean, yeah.
Was this the first date?
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
And then my question to her was, well, did you have any garlic? Because now your face is going to smell like garlic. I mean, really. I mean, who does
so
that?
That's strange.
Yes, he did. He licked her face. I mean, I said, well, did you have some chocolate left over that he was just trying to?
It's got to be a fetish or something.
I've never heard of that in my life, let alone someone we know.
It's funny and scary and disgusting and
all
disturbing.
At the same time. I mean, all at the same time. All right, and the second one. Okay. So this is pre-online dating. So this is, I heard this one yesterday or day before. And so back in the day, apparently, they used Craigslist.
Back in the day. Okay.
Back in the day. They used
Craigslist. That doesn't happen anymore.
No, yeah. Craigslist and Messenger. Like, so there wasn't pictures to be sent over. There was nothing. Like, you're just kind of blind going in, right? And she said he was just laying it on thick, you know, everything she wanted to hear. Well, apparently they go on a date and he hands her this box. And I was like, oh, and she's like, oh, thank you so much. I like this. And so he's like, no, open it. So she said, okay, can we sit down? He's like, oh, just open it now. I'm just like, we're going to sit down. He opens it up. There's like long black lace thigh highs.
Oh my God.
He said, what did you say when that happened? She's like, I don't know what to say. I was just like, thank you. And they had dinner. I said, okay, well, what happened? She's like, nothing. He left. We didn't. And I said, well, what? How was the second date? She said, there was no second date. And I said, well, did you keep the thigh highs? She's like, yes. And she's like, and then he called me that he would like them returned to her or to him. And I said, well, hold on a second. That's odd. And she goes, yeah, what was really odd is that, like, they lived, like, 30 minutes away. And she said, you literally spent more in gas than you did to actually get him. So he was adamant that he'd get it. And so she actually had to go to the restaurant where they met. And sure enough, she left a little bag of that on there. So that is
so strange.
Like, I mean, she's just like, what is it? Like, does he just kind of reuse them, like, and ask for them back, like, take them back and, like, you know.
Wow.
Put it together. I mean, really? I can't even stand it.
I don't miss dating. I have some funny stories of my time with dating, but I'm not going to revisit it because it's just absurd. The stuff that, I mean, just comes out of nowhere, you know? And so we're going to talk a little bit about our pet peeves later. But
It's good. So we're going to take a quick break here. So Jacob, and we'll be back in a second to talk about mind and body tips. And we're back with Molly, President and CEO of the SOAR Community Network. Thanks again, Molly, being here.
This is so much fun.
So much fun. Oh, and it's about to get real funny here. So we're going to talk about the profiles, swiper, no swiping. The profile dating or dating profiles, the do's and don'ts, right? So I'm going to say the do's, right, have a wow statement like you would in business. Like have a professional picture done, at least the first one, right? You don't have the one for LinkedIn. I mean, let's be honest.
Or at least have a picture, because there's some folks that just have that little, you know,
silhouette. Your phone doesn't do it. No, yeah, they're pretty sure they have high quality lenses in that.
I wonder how many people actually get like swiped when they don't have a picture.
Oh, I mean, I can tell you, I swipe away. Yeah, I wouldn't know. What are you hiding? I mean, if we're going out there, we're being out, you know, I'm out there. So no, but I would say, but here's a pet peeve, sunglasses. Having sunglasses on, especially if you're indoors, is weird. I mean, what are you hiding?
Well, also, I think people want to know, like, excuse me, there's something to be said about, like, looking at someone and seeing their eyes.
Yeah.
Even
windows
if it's far
soul,
away,
right?
You still feel like there's connection. It just feels like a wall is there when you can't see someone's eyes. I mean, it feels just, I think energetically it just feels off. Like, what is going on there?
Yeah, no, it's weird. And this guy had, okay, so let's just put the scene there for a hot second. So he was literally in a crouching tiger, hidden dragon stance, like punching, like trying to punch with sunglasses on inside. I'm like, what are you trying to fight me? Like, I will kick. Like, I am serious. Like, do now you want to, I mean, that's not how you're going to, I wonder if he gets swiped by anybody. I mean, it's weird. I mean, that's a live person who's on there. I'm like, really? It was just strange. But then I saw some really weird tattoos that were like another guy, same deal, inside, sunglasses, main profile picture. And he had like, do you remember in high school? And it was right here. It was like right in this region, right? So you can see. It was like flags, like you know, swimming flag, like swimming, like swimming pool. You know those flags for that's what it was. And that was it. And I was like, I mean, can't. Was it about like color or like?
Well, what is your opinion about women who have profiles that are very provocative, like, you know, in bathing suits, but just. I guess it depends on how they're posed too, right? Like, what is the impression? Because I have, and I only ask because I don't care about that, but I know a lot of my guy friends, they make these like stupid comments about those pictures.
What do they say? I want to hear that.
Well, because it's like they don't even read the bio. They're like commenting on, you know, what she looks like before anything else. So I guess I'm just curious about your opinion. Like, how do you feel about those profiles? Like, what should we do and not do? Because on
I
the
think
one
it
hand,
depends on the
yeah,
person.
You can express, you can be happy and confident about your body. But on the other hand, like, what's the intention? Because I have some, I mean, my guy friends are great, but they're also men and they're being silly. And the first thing they comment on is the body.
Right.
And then before they even read the bio.
Right.
So it's kind of like, you know.
I guess it really depends on who you are as a person, like what you're putting out there first and or what you really want.
Yeah, what's your goal,
what's
right,
your goal?
For being on the site,
right?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, if your goal is just to hook up, that's one thing. If your goal is to have a relationship or get married or you know, whatever. I mean, just you got to watch how you're putting your product
that's
on,
true.
Right? Because now you are your brand in the dating world.
It just depends on what you want and what you're okay with right now. So that's fine. But I was just laughing. I was just thinking about that. I'm like, okay, you know, if the intention is to have them get to know you, like my guy friends are not going there first. They're like commenting on like how cute you are or what's, you know, this about your body. It's
oh my
just crazy.
God. I may share. No, I'm not going to do it tonight. But that was stuff I received as aggressive.
Wow.
And I don't even have like a, you know, a bathing suit shot up there. But I mean, you got to have a full body shot on one of the pictures though, so they can kind of, and be recent pictures, people. Recent. I've seen ones where like you could tell were Polaroids like 20, 30 years ago.
So what are the popular sites now? Because I mean, I've been out of the dating scene forever and I've not been online dating, and I don't think I've ever been on online dating actually.
So there's actually a few. So there's Tinder, there's Bumble, Zeus, Plenty of Fish, Match, eHarmony. And I think you kind of have to see, Farmers Only. Oh, let's talk about that. Oh my God, because I love this. I mean, they are brilliant. I mean, talk about specific target market. If you are into farmers, right? You want a farming lifestyle. I mean, you know what you're going to get. You know,
this is real.
This is 100% real.
Wow.
Yeah, and I thought to myself, there needs more of like niche ones like that. You know, wow. I mean, that was literally, you know, maybe just for some creative types. And
it's actually kind of cool. I like the niching it down because you kind of know that you're like-minded, right? And you don't have millions of people. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's cool. I've never heard of that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I'm so out of it.
No, I had to give it up. One of my other guests had brought it up when we were talking about, you know, sales and how sales and dating is so similar. Mm-hmm. You know, knowing your kind of target market.
Got it.
Right?
The niche thing.
The niche thing. And it makes sense. It's good. Yeah. I can guarantee those profiles, no one's punching with sunglasses on, like ninja style. I mean, come on.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So, I'm not even going to do the last one. I did see this one guy. I mean, he's a huge guy. I mean, huge. And sunglasses again, but wasn't it outside? It's different if you're outside. Like, I get it.
Right.
You know, I mean, I have a picture up there with me and like when I was hiking, you know, with sunglasses. It makes sense. You can tell there's sun's coming down. It's sunny. Right? I'm serious. Okay? But he literally had, like, I don't know, it looked like a crocodile, like, MERS/backpack. And I'm like, I don't even know what that is.
Did you read the profile?
I mean, this
is so interesting because we're talking about this and we're saying do's and don'ts and we're focusing so much on the pictures. Which just goes to show like how important it is because the whole 10 minutes we've been talking about, we've been focusing on like that first impression.
Yeah.
So
first impression.
I think that's probably like the number one thing to consider.
Yeah. You know, and put those pictures up that tell a story about you, about your personality. What can people kind of get from like, hey, I may be a match for them. I may not be, right? I mean, don't kind of waste your time, you know, and just if they're not the right. But I would strongly suggest write a witty description. Take time, read it. I mean, I know me and the girls, you know, that are on them. If they don't have a description, I mean, a lot of times I'm just like, meh. You don't even have time to
write. You don't know anything about them.
Do you know anything about yourself? Can't come up with some emoticons. I mean...
How do you feel about getting somebody else to write your profile?
'Cause I know, 100%.
Yeah, because I know a lot of my friends who are dating online, they're like, I'm just so stuck. Like, I don't know what to write. I don't know how to be witty because it just feels weird to write a profile about yourself. At the same time, I mean, I think about the authenticity of it. So I don't know how you feel about that.
No, I think, I mean, you have our good friends. Like, it's just like a testimonial, right, in business. Like, have someone write something about you because it's hard about, you know, having to write about yourself. I mean, I have the new website, the Dating Advisor website that's coming up in a couple weeks. And I was on with Cicerina, and I was like, guys, I can't write about myself. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, you can take some of the information and, you know, help me with it. But, you know, it's hard to do that.
Yeah.
But I would highly suggest having someone else write, you know, your profile description and be witty and be you, because don't try to be someone you're not. Like I said, the dating tip, just be yourself, because like, I don't know who someone said, like, there's a kettle for every pot, right? I mean, so that was that. But, you know, like I would say, someone else I was talking to. Oh, there was a great quote that I did see by one guy wrote. He's like, girls want to find Superman, but walk past Clark Kent every day. I was like, oh, it's true. You know,
it's true. My husband tells me all the time, you guys always talk about the bad boys, and you know, then you complain all the time about the bad boys and you overlook all the good guys. So it's very interesting because what we're attracted to, and this is a perfect segment into some of the questions that you're going to ask later.
When you
depending on where you are in life, you look for different things.
Sure.
So like this conversation that you and I are having now about dating and profiles and online dating, 5 years from now might be a whole different conversation
because
it's based on where we are, right? But when I was younger in my 20s, I definitely was attracted to a different kind of person, look, feel, energy. And then as I get older, those things don't attract me anymore.
Right.
And it's weird because it just kind of happened, right? Like I think life and experiences just allow that to happen because the type of guy that I would consider to be sexy or hot when I was younger doesn't do anything for me now.
Yeah.
Which is crazy, right? Because you would think that would stay, but it doesn't. It changes. And and also what you want out of life changes. So what you attract and what you're attracted to changes.
And you have to be like someone on the same level of like, you know, here are the things that I want. Like same kind of core non-negotiables because it just becomes just too off the rails, so to speak.
Definitely.
Here's the one thing. These are dating sites. The point of them is to make a date with someone or make a meeting. It's not, like I said last week, 900 years, you're not Yoda, to just text back and forth. But, you know, I've had this conversation with the girls, and them sit and say, you know, people just want to text for like 2-3 weeks. Okay, like I'm literally just gonna unmatch, like, you know, because it's just pointless. Like, you don't wanna, I mean, I'm sure you have friends, yeah. Right? Like, I mean, you want, just set up a coffee date or a meeting or a call, because you probably be the only person that does, because everybody wants to text.
But Jen, do you think that's a generational thing too?
The people,
you know, because I mean,
not our age group, the people I'm talking to.
Well,
they should be liking the phone. Well, actually, all guys hate phones, so they hate to talk on the phone, apparently. So, in general.
No, I'm just saying that because I think dating is so different from, like, when I was dating. And I'm not that old, but I mean, no. I'm definitely not in my 20s. So, I think the mindset of how dating works now, I think it's also in the context of just, you know, how people meet, how people communicate. I mean, the texting thing is such a common everyday thing now.
Yeah. I mean, it's fine. Like, I text, but I like to talk on the phone. I mean, I talk to all you girls all the time on the phone. I mean, but I still like that kind of communication because you can hear the tones. Like, you know, you send a text and they said, oh, yeah.
You can interpret it.
You can interpret it 20 different ways.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, yeah. Like, oh, here's an example. This was funny. So I was talking to one of our girlfriends. She's like, he has not texted me back in 2 hours. I said, I'm done. I'm breaking up with him. Wow. I'm never talking to him ever again. I hate him. Like, all these things, right? And this is a long time ago. And so anyway, so then like 10 minutes later, she's like, oh, look at the nice heart emoticon. I just love him so much.
Oh,
I'm
my
like,
gosh.
Girl.
Yeah, I think it's all that instant gratification, too.
Yeah.
And we're so scared. We're so scared. Like, when we finally like somebody, we are starting to invest. And before we invest, we want to know, like, are they on the same pace? And I think also this is interesting because I think this is the same thing that happens with courting clients.
Yes.
Right? Like, you're going out there, you're networking, you're meeting, you're reading their profiles, you're preparing for the meeting.
Yeah.
And the first meeting is great. And then you send out the proposal. And then you kind of wait, like, oh, what, did I do something wrong? What are the pricing right? What's going on? I haven't heard from them for the next couple of days. You know, it's interesting, but it's that it's a human thing where we want to know right away.
Right.
And we don't let the natural sometimes course of life do what it's supposed to do. Like, the client is supposed to read the proposal and talk with their team and decide, you know.
Get references.
Versus, and so it's something that we have to watch for.
Yeah. Oh, I love that analogy. That's really good.
To watch for that.
No. All right. So now we're going to get our next segment, and we're going to talk about my clack attack questions, so my firing away questions.
Okay.
So what is your favorite rom-com?
Oh, my gosh. You know, when I got this question, there are so many. So I love My Big Fat Greek Wedding.
Yes.
There's Notting Hill.
Yep.
Some Kind of Wonderful must be my all-time favorite. That's a classic.
Clearly.
80s. I love that one so much. Gosh, so many. The Holiday. Love Actually. I can go on and on.
Yeah.
I'm a romantic comedy girl.
Yeah, me too. Love them.
It drives my husband crazy sometimes because he loves action and horror flicks, and I don't do those.
I can't do horror. I mean, I have the worst dreams. I'm most
no,
dreams.
I can't do,
I can't do it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm too much of an
hashtag,
empath, I think.
Yeah. No.
So those are some I'm just throwing, and My Best Friend's Wedding.
Yes.
I love that,
I love
one,
that
too.
One too.
Just, I'm so sappy.
Yeah,
so
me
yeah.
Too. Yeah, I love it. All right. Who is your celebrity crush?
Ooh. You know, it's a new crush. It's a brand new crush. It's this new television show called This Is Us.
Yes.
And it's not even so much the actor himself, it's the character that
he plays.
Actor portrays, which
right.
is Jack.
That's
the name of the character on the show, which is the father.
Yeah.
So that's my super crush. And it's not just the look of this actor, but it's like what he represents, you know?
And
we were talking about this before the show. It's amazing that I'm attracted to and crushing on characteristics of a person and a soul versus just their looks.
Exactly.
And that was not the way it was when I was a lot younger.
Yeah.
So I would say that. And then, you know, I love goofy, funny guys. So like I have a crush on Jimmy Fallon and Trevor Noah, you know? So So those would be some of my celebrity crushes.
Yeah. I would say, I'm still going to say Chris Pine.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
he's pretty.
It's aggressive, the hotness. I mean, it's true. That's what I said last week with Mayma. I mean, seriously. I'm trying to think, who are the other ones? Chris Hemsworth.
Mm-hmm.
He's hot, especially in Thor.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, when he came out in Thor, I was like, wow.
Oh, yeah. That's an understatement. Yeah, so that's where I was. So what would you say the number one quality, like we talked a little bit about, so I have probably a quality that you look for in a partner?
Ever since I was a little girl, when you dream about love and stuff, I always said to myself, the number one thing that I look for in a man, in a life partner, is kindness. Yeah. Like, just, you know, when even before you start dating and when you're friends, watch how he treats the people around him. Watch how he talks to his mother, his sister, his friends. And watch how he treats waiters, and does he hold doors for people? You know, how does he treat children and the elderly? Like, it's amazing, but you can do a lot. Learn a lot from observing someone when they don't think you're looking. So kindness, number one, for sure. Kindness.
Yeah, that's awesome. What's the strangest gift you've ever received?
So a funny one. A girlfriend, maybe she wasn't such a friend. Maybe she was more of an acquaintance.
Okay.
She gave me a makeup bag.
Okay.
With a used lipstick inside. So I think it was a re-gift. So that was funny.
Like, how far was it used? Was it just like gently, let me just try this on before I give it to her?
It was like almost down to the end. I think she just forgot to take it out of the bag because she was cleaning it out. That was funny. I was like, the bag is cute though, but that was funny. And then I got a rock once, but it was pretty cool because when I turned over the rock, I was like, you know, I looked at the rock and I turned it over and it said, "You rock." So I was like,
because she does rock.
Aw. So that was pretty cool.
Yeah. I think a strangest gift I got, true story, was a used candle with no wick. I'm like, what do you do with that? I mean, do I just try to mold my new candle? I'm just like, what the hell? What is wrong with you? And they said, I bought it like that. It must have came like that. I'm like, yeah, after you burned it. That's exactly what happened, apparently. Wow. just saying. Highest irritation factor.
Oh, this was hard. I was thinking about, because you know me, it takes a lot to get me upset.
Yeah.
It's always been that way. But I would say no shows. I thought a lot about this. No shows really are irritating for me.
Yeah, just like you commit to something and then...
And I'm not talking about like letting someone know that you're going to be late or that you can't make it last minute. That's fine because life happens.
Yeah.
But you go to a meeting or you're going to the date or you're doing whatever, you spend your whole time getting there, hours, and no call, no text, no show. And then they don't even tell you that they forgot or anything. It's just kind of like they just ghost you. And then you see them next time at an event or somewhere else. It's like, hey, like nothing happened. So that's what I don't like, is just, you know, tell the truth.
Yeah.
Just tell the truth. And if you forgot, like, call the next day and say you forgot. That's much more forgivable than just pretending like
it didn't happen. Yeah. That's crazy. I've never had that happen, but oh my gosh.
Well, I was in financial services and it happened a lot.
Oh, jeez. Oh, God. Okay, so before we wrap up the show, what would you say, like, you have your awesome gratitude book here. Like, how do you start your day matters? We talk about the mind and body.
Yeah.
How you start your day. So can you kind of go through how you start your day?
Well, I think we were talking about, like, what's the first thing I do when I open my eyes, when I wake up in the morning, and I take in a deep breath. Mm-hmm. And I've been doing that, I think, for, like, the past 7 years or so. And it comes from just the experiences of losses that I've had.
Yeah.
Got a lot of death that I've experienced over the past few years. And, you know, also being in those situations, four of those passings, I was the last person to be with them. And when you see someone take their last breath, you really, really value your breath. So in the morning, that's kind of my homage to life, my gratitude moment is like, and then I do stretches, and then I do 5 minutes of meditation, even before I get out of bed, actually, because, you know, people get nervous about meditation, but meditation is how you define it. It's a moment where you, like, pause your thoughts and go to a different level, a different space, so that you can clear the way for clarity. And clear the way for clarity. That's, like, you know, trying to make sense, but that's what you want, is calm and peace before you even start the day. And then I do EFT, emotional freedom technique, and a friend of mine, Bev, taught me how to do that many years ago. So it's tapping, and you just use your fingertips and you move energy through your body. So
that's awesome.
Those are my routines. And then I have my gratitude log, and a friend of mine gave me this. Shout out to Amra. Thank you so much. I love you. And I put it in my purse and I carry it with me, and I write down just things that happen, you know, in my life, in the moment, that just make me feel grateful to be alive.
Yeah. Well, that's
and
awesome.
That helps. That helps.
That's good. Okay, so as we're wrapping up the show today, Molly, so how can everybody get in touch with you?
Well, it's very easy to find me because we're on social media. For the business, you just go to soarcommunitynetwork.com and soar as in soar, S-O-A-R, and Facebook, LinkedIn, all of that, S-E-N. And for me, you just Google my name on, Google search,
Facebook,
Safari,
Twitter,
wherever.
He's everywhere.
And you find Molly Pompidou.
Yes,
so thank you so much for having me.
You.
This was a lot of fun.
Yeah, so don't forget to tune in next week. We're going to have an amazing upcoming show with Melanie Springus-Serena, so can't wait for that. Anyway, have a great week, everybody, and take care. See ya.
Bye.